We are live and we're going to talk about the poultry.
And behind me, you can see the chicken who follows me around. Favorite chicken.
Okay, so that was the idyllic situation that we had on my farm, my little hobby farm of 10 acres, until the fox showed up. And I'm going to give you a timeline so you'll understand. And I'm really only talking about things that happened this year because I got these chickens and ducks in 2020 in the spring, and they were five little baby chicks and five little baby ducklings. And we did lose some that first year. There was Pee Wee, who was killed by a dog, but he had been a handicapped duck. And you can go back and hear all about that. And then we lost a couple of chickens. So at the beginning of this year, I had four ducks and three chickens. Of the ducks, one was a drake, and his name was Drake, and the others were Daffy and Petunia and Misty. And from the chickens, I only had one named, and that was Favorite Chicken. And the reason she was my favorite is because she would sit on my lap and she would follow me around. And the reason she did that is because Drake was always picking on her, and she knew if she sat in my lap or was very close to me, Drake couldn't do anything for her. So that was the situation. Now, just so that we don't get confused, everything was fine until June 10th, when I noticed, you know, it was the day that I saw a butterfly, a beautiful, great spangled Fritillary butterfly on my milkweed flower that had just bloomed. And I was going back from looking at that flower, and I saw the three female ducks walking around together, and I was looking around for Drake. And the reason, at first I just suspected that Drake was going after Favorite Chicken, and you know, sometimes he would leave his flock just to go pester her, and they would stand idly by waiting for him. So I was worried that maybe he was pestering Favorite Chicken, but he wasn't. And all day I saw them walking, the three of them, the three female ducks, alone and without him. And I didn't know what happened until the next day I saw the fox. And of course, I saw him from a distance, and it's not very clear, but I am going to show you footage of that. You know, if you're a city person, maybe you've seen more foxes than I have. You know, I was talking to Julia, and Julia said, "What, you'd never seen a fox before?" And I said, "Yeah, I saw a fox. I saw one by the school, but I never saw one on my property, though I believed that there was one." You know, there were signs that indicated to me that there was a fox on the property, but wild foxes do not just come up to you in broad daylight and talk to you or take food from you, you know. And a lot of people have been suggesting, why don't you just feed the fox? First of all, the fox won't come up to me. It's very odd that I saw it at all. So I will share the footage of that with you as well. Yeah, because I know a lot of you have met foxes or you've fed foxes, but that must be in a city area where the situation with wildlife is completely different. Our foxes are truly wild. So Anyway, I saw the fox, so I pretty much suspected the fox had killed Drake, although I never saw body or, you know, indications, feathers, whatever. But then on June the 14th, the dogs were barking. I ran out the door and I saw the fox, and the fox had something in his mouth, and it was a duck. It was a dead duck. And I ran after him. No, I don't have footage of that because that happened so fast. I ran after him into the woods and I lost him. But then I turned around and I saw that he had dropped Misty. It was Misty that he got. She had a broken neck. She was not alive any longer. So then at that point, you know, I realized that he was a threat. And I put up, you know, I can't catch them, you know, but they come in every evening to the coop, and I locked them up in the coop. And then I did not, you know, on the 15th, I didn't let them out. I mean, there's a little underneath the coop, there's a yard, and then they can go upstairs to sleep. And so they were confined to that. On June the 18th, Petunia got very antsy, and she tried to escape while I was feeding them. Petunia is one of the ducks, and I caught her and put her back, but Favorite Chicken got out while I was doing that, and she was free that whole entire day. She kept pretty close to the house, but she was all over the place, and then she came back in the evening and agreed to go back in the coop. And then I never let her out again. On June 21st, even though I hadn't let them out and they were all secured in the pen, when I went out to look, I saw that somehow the fox had gotten one of the chickens and had chopped its head off. And the body was hanging out of a gap in the pen. Since then, I've been securing the pen more. But there was another thing that I saw that I believe the fox did, because I've never seen this before. I found a box turtle's body, and its arms and legs were all out like this, and its head was missing. But it was so wasteful. You know, it's such a wasteful thing to do, to kill and just take the head. So I'm wondering if this is a normal fox, but I've asked locals and they said that anything is possible. So anyway, I'm going to share with you my other video, which is sort of a kind of a retrospective, but it starts very close to the time when all of this happened. So I'm going to go here. So this would be, I think, in February or, you know, early in the year, you know, and my ducks and my chickens are free. They are free to roam. And, you know, they compete with each other. Drake is the one who is making those noises that you hear. And, you know, on my property, there's a lot of wildlife. So over here, you can see that there were some deer very close to the house. And so I left the flock and I went to follow the deer. You can see how close I am to them. And these are wild deer, so they're not going to come to me. It's not like they're tame or they'll be fed by me or anything like that. They are wild deer. And I'm following them here. The littlest one. Watch him speed up. And here's another one. Okay, so this is the time. This is the day. On this day, Drake disappeared. That's the day when I saw that he was missing. But this is a retrospective of them. Okay. I was just so excited by the, I had waited for my milkweed to bloom, and I was so excited to see the butterfly so close up. And of course, very shortly after the flower blooms, it disappears altogether. But this is a great spangled Fritillary. Or Fritillary, as they say. Okay, I'm gonna move it forward. So as I was walking back, I saw the chickens, I saw the three ducks, and it was strange not to have Drake with them. And I turned a corner and I saw another chicken. And I didn't really know what was going on. But Drake was gone. He was already gone. Okay, and this is where I saw the fox. The next day, I saw the fox. It was in my front yard. This is as close as I could get to him. He was looking at me. And in a way, I was thrilled to see the fox. I had not seen a fox the 20 years that I've been living on this property. And here was this fox. And so it was a really big deal for me that I saw it. And later, I saw another milkweed flower in the place where it had been. After I saw the fox, I saw the, I wanted to show you right after I wanted to check and see where my flock was, because the fox was in the front yard, and these were my flock, the remaining ones, all of them together, three chickens and three ducks. That's how many I had at the time. This is the something else flower, the Carolina rose. Okay, I'm going to now remove that. So right now I only have two chickens. One of them is favorite chicken and the other is the other chicken. And I have the head duck, Daffy, and I have Petunia, and they're all cooped up and they're not happy and they're not laying eggs, and this is not how I raise them, and that's not how they, you know, they're not free range right now, and I don't know, you know, I don't know when I can release them. And one of my viewers said, well, safety first. But does safety really come first? And this is so, so terribly confusing for me. I'm not sure what I should do. So on the one hand, for the longest time, I wanted to see a fox. I wrote a whole book about trying to see a fox, and believing that there is one, even though you couldn't see it. On the other hand, I also wrote a book about a concentration camp, an internment camp in China. And in that internment camp, there's a Japanese commandant who tells the internees that they are there for their own protection. He tells them that Chinese will kill them if they were released. And that doesn't seem realistic to the internees because they've been living among the Chinese all this time. But as the novel progresses, you find out that, you know, there are nice Chinese and there are not so nice Chinese. And the Chinese communists are going around killing people. So, you know, I don't know whether my chickens and ducks are convinced that I'm protecting them from the fox, or whether they think that I just put them, you know, into a situation in the coop where they're sitting ducks, where they would have more of a chance if I just let them loose. And that's what I'm struggling with. Any own safety, we have to be, you know, put away somewhere. It can be very, you know, it can seem as though somebody is just trying to And of course, I ache over this with Bo too. I've got a beautiful property, which I would like to share with all my animals. I would like them all to be able to roam free. But now even my chickens and my ducks can't do it. And, you know, I've also spoken to some farmers and they said, well, what you need to do is you need to shoot the fox. And I said, well, isn't the fox protected? And they said, if he's going after your livestock and you can prove that they're going after your animals, then you are allowed to shoot it. Well, I don't think that I really want to. I've been waiting all this time to see a fox. So that's not my inclination. But I do think that we need to think about how the behavior of foxes and of wolves and of other predators is shaped by the behavior of human beings, even stray dogs. When I lived in Taiwan, I could walk down the street and there would be stray dogs walking down the street as well. And whenever they saw me, they would cross over to the other side of the street. They wouldn't bother me. So basically there were stray dogs and they kept their distance from humans. If I offered to share my food with a stray dog, he wouldn't take it. Now, I imagine that the reason for that is that there had been attempts to poison them and that somehow the dogs, the wild dogs had shared this information with each other. And maybe mothers taught their cubs, their puppies, not to take food from strangers. And all of this was ingrained. But what you have there is maybe because there was pushback from the humans, it was actually a situation where the strays could be tolerated because they were not a danger to humans and they were not pests. They didn't go around, you know, taking our food or pestering us to feed them. And I think, you know, for instance, in the United States, there's like zero tolerance for stray dogs in most cities. You know, when I was in a city environment. So if a stray is walking around, that's going to be reported and will be picked up. And the only dogs that are tolerated are dogs that are owned and leashed and kept under tight control by humans. I think that, you know, for the past 3 years, almost 3 years, when I've had my ducks and my chickens in the front yard, and they had free run of all of my property, that the fact that that there was one dog that was not under control, and then, you know, but the fact that there were no dogs most of the time attacking them, the fact that we know that there are coyotes, you know, we hear them howling every night, and the coyotes never came and attacked my chickens and ducks. This seems to indicate that there is kind of an equilibrium, a balance, a natural balance between the predators that are here and the humans and their animals that they have domesticated. And it was possible to do this, you know, to raise the chickens and ducks in the front yard and keep most of them for 2.5, almost 3 years. And the question is, can I never go back to that? I'm not even sure whether the fox is still out there. It's not like he's available for me to look at. I don't know where he is. Okay, I have a comment. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, California Mountain Art and Life. You say it's interesting to hear about the equilibrium. Yeah, you know, for the longest time, we know that we have all these other predators out there. And, you know, as a thinking person, I know that life and death happen every day out there in nature. Birds are eaten. Snakes eat mice. It's not like I think it's all peaceful out there in nature. It's not. And it's all one food chain, you know. Yeah, unless one is rabid. I was wondering about that. But I talked to some farmers and they said they don't think the fox is rabid, and they think that this behavior, it could be normal. I don't know. It's not normal for me. But then, you know, when I told them about how the fox managed to get the head of one of the hens through the gap, for a moment, they thought that, could that have been a raccoon? And I said, no, we had a raccoon running around here, a mother raccoon with her babies last year. And she didn't bother the chickens and ducks. She just went in there and tried to eat the chicken feed. You know, that's what she did. And so I told my farmer friend about that. And they said, well, that sounds like a raccoon that didn't know it's a raccoon. I don't know. I think this is normal for raccoons too. So my experience with foxes and raccoons might be different from somebody else's. Yeah, California Mountain Art and Life said that is interesting to hear. Yeah, so I really don't know what to do. There's a part of me that really wants to release my remaining hens and ducks and let them fend for, you know, I feed them and they have a home and they do come in at night, and I do lock them up at night even when they're allowed to roam. So it's not that I would abandon them. I feel really bad for them being cooped up like this because they're not used to it and they're not laying any eggs. So there's no profit in this for me, and they're just not happy. And of course, they might be mourning their lost friends as well. I don't, you know, if I did try to let them out now, I'm pretty sure favorite chicken would come out. I don't know about the others. And favorite chicken seems to know how to get by, you know, because she was loose for a whole day that one time when she got away from me and nothing happened to her. And then, you know, the next day or day after that, one of the chickens was killed, but it wasn't favorite chicken. So and that chicken just somehow got too close to the gap and was caught in the mouth of the fox. I don't know if the fox is still out here. There's another issue with all of this is that we're having kind of a semi-drought. Now, at the beginning of the season, you know, in the spring and beginning of the summer, we had a lot of rain. It rained almost every day. I felt as if I lived in a rainforest. It looked that way. It was so lush and it was raining all the time. But now it hasn't rained in, I don't know, 2 weeks. And the ground is cracking. Okay. I also wonder about the hawks. The hawks do eat squirrels and chickens are not much larger. Yeah, I think that one hawk did get one of my chickens this year. But I don't know if you saw in the footage that I gave you of favorite chicken. She was actually crouching down when the hawks were flying overhead looking for, I think they were mostly looking for rodents. But yeah, she knows how to get by. She really does. I think she's smarter than the other ones. You know, not necessarily lucky and not obedient, you know, and she would not submit to Drake. And so he would, you know, hurt her, but yeah, favorite chicken is very adept. She knows how to get by. So I don't know. I think if I let them loose, she would probably survive. I'm most concerned for the ducks. They can't run very fast, and this breed of ducks cannot fly. The chickens can fly better than they can. Not that the chickens fly very far, but they can kind of swoop up into a tree, and the ducks can't. So it's not a coincidence that, you know, he managed to run off with two ducks. I don't know. I mean, I really don't know. I don't want to be like Commandant Izu in my book, Our Lady of Kaifeng, when I'm thinking I'm taking care of them and they are, you know, I'm keeping them safe from the bad fox. But is it really safe for them to be cooped up like that? Now, some people have said you need to buy a bigger coop. But just so you know, right now I only have four of them, and that particular coop that I have was designed for four. So they are not overcrowded in it. And I used to have in the backyard a much larger walk-in coop with a yard to it. And what happened was the dogs one day were able to open the door and they killed all of the chickens. So that's how I decided that in the future, I was not going to do it that way. I wasn't going to have a walk-in coop. I was going to have a very small coop for them to go in at night. Okay, and we have somebody who likes to say okay. And someone here among my chat. So yeah, I could get a bigger coop. I could get a coop that I can move around. Because if you give them a yard any place, the yard soon becomes very muddy and very dusty and doesn't have any grass growing in it, even though originally there was grass there. So you would have to move it around, but it still would be like a cage. So I don't know. I don't know what to do. Yeah, it would be nice if William did have more to say. Okay, that's nice. That's nice. I'm glad you're listening. Okay, yeah, so I could get a much bigger coop, but I don't think that that would resolve the issue of the chickens and the ducks not being able to roam on their own. They have plenty of food, but, you know, not necessarily all the different variety of foods that they used to get when they went walking, because they could find insects, and when it was raining, the little earthworms would come out and they would get those. And there are all sorts of seeds and flowers and any number of things. I remember we had wild sunflowers were growing in the yard. It was in the area that had been mowed by the electric company. And that was during their first year, when they had just graduated from being ducklings and chicks, and they were very young. And they went out there, and I saw them, you know, eating the seeds from the wild sunflowers, and it was so beautiful. I mean, I always enjoy them. And when it rains, the rain often leaves puddles, and there are actually streams running on the side of the road, and the ducks love to swim in that. And all of that made me so happy to see, and I think it made them happy. And it was so idyllic, and just allowing this one fox to ruin all of that, when I know that the world is full of other predators. You know, I know that the sky is a roll of hawks, and there are coyotes that come out at night every single night. Oh, you love wild sunflowers. Oh, yeah. You know, some people think that every little thing that isn't planted by man is a weed and has to be cut down. But those things provide food, if not for us, then for the other animals. Yeah, I know. So anyway, that's why on my acreage, you know, I deal with conservation a little bit different from my friend Kathy, although I very much admire the way she does it. But on my land, I just mostly let things alone most of the time. I just let things grow the way they're going to grow. And that's why what used to be a pasture is now becoming wooded. It's a wooded area. Okay, well, I don't know about killing with kindness, and I don't know what you mean by that. Do you mean I should give sugar to the fox? The thing is, I cannot find the fox, and I cannot give him anything. Some people suggested, oh, the fox must be hungry. Why don't you leave some fresh meat outside for the fox, and then he won't bother your chickens and ducks? I don't think so. I can't just leave fresh meat out. I'm not going to kill other animals to put out there for him. He's a fox. He should be hunting live animals that are plentiful on my land. There are rabbits. There are mice. There are voles. There are squirrels and occasional birds that he can hunt, you know. And I don't have to, you know, I'm not watching every sparrow, and I don't, you know, mourn over every animal that dies. I don't even know about it. And that's just the way of nature. And it would be fine for me if. Yeah, let's see. The fox must just say thank you, eat it, and then come around wanting more. Yeah, I'm just not going to do that. I don't think that's the right thing to do. Yeah, well, I don't know about this being nice to others when they're mean to us. What I have found is that you have to have pushback. Somebody's mean to you, you have to push back. Oh, really? How did that work out with the people buying honey for a wild bear? Doesn't sound like a good idea. Do you want to tell us the story? Because I actually don't know what happened in that situation. I think that you do have to push back. You don't necessarily have to be extra mean, but this business of turning the other cheek, such as saying, "Oh, you killed one of my ducks. Here, have another duck." I don't think so. That's not exactly how I look at things. Okay, says not well. The man left the door of his house open. He thought it was great, and then people freaked out. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, Bo knows about all these situations, but Bo is asleep tonight. So, and so are my remaining chickens and ducks. And also, I have two dogs. Are Romy and Leo. And Romy is guarding the laundry room, and Leo is asleep on my bed. Romy and Leo kind of let me know that something was going on, so that was the time when I ran after the fox, but he'd already gotten Misty. Yeah, but I mean, we had such wonderful times. And I don't really know, you know, I don't have a solution. I occasionally do an episode about the dogs. Do you remember? I think we did one that was called, we might have done one together, that was called The Dogs We Used to Know, where we talked about all of our old dogs from over the years. Is home my favorite place? Well, I've got 10 acres. So right now, yes, I love being at home. I love being on my property. And that's where I have all my animals that I love. Yes, we did that. But I could do an update, you know, on Romy and Leo. Situation with Romy and Leo is also a little bit weird. You know, Leo is, yes, I can do that. I can, in fact, give you an update right now about it. So Leo is the dog that, you know, that we had since he was a puppy. He's a Sheltie Beagle mix. And, you know, and now he's getting up in age. I don't remember. He might be 8 years old. And, but he still looks like a puppy. And then there is Romy, Romeo. He's a blue heeler. And he came to us in 2019. I remember that because our friend Lon was visiting us, and this dog appeared the very same day that Lon came to visit. So it was a dog that belonged to the neighbors across the street, you know. And when I say the neighbors across the street, those neighbors change all the time because they're renters. So I end up with a lot of the dogs belonging to the different neighbors across the street. So anyway, because they abandoned him and he was sleeping on my porch, I adopted Romeo, you know, and we named him Romeo. We're not doing that. Sorry, you're not doing a fight here. I don't set people up to fight. So actually, what happened was that Romeo thinks he should dominate Leo, but Leo is, as far as I'm concerned, is they leave their dogs and cats behind. They do. And, you know, so this has happened a lot of times. So anyway, I adopted Romeo, and for a while, both of them were sleeping on my bed at night. But then Romeo thought that he should be sleeping at the head of the bed close to me. And he kept trying to push Leo aside, and Leo wouldn't have that. And they got into a fight and blood was drawn. And so I put an end to that. So now Romeo sleeps in the laundry room, and Leo sleeps with me in the bed. I love them both, and they're fine together in the backyard as long as I don't go out there. If I go out there, then Romeo thinks he has to do something to Leo because he doesn't want me to show any favor at all to Leo. And he thinks that he should attack Leo. And so that's very uncomfortable for me. So I play with each of them separately. I feed each of them separately. I'm kind to each of them separately. But no, I do not want them to fight. I don't like that. And I keep them separated during the times when they would fight. But you know what? They're actually very good friends when nobody else is there. So sometimes I look through the window and I see them in the backyard, and I see that they're playing very nicely with each other. So as long as jealousy over me or some other human is not involved, they're fine together. Yeah, well, here's the thing. He's a blue heeler. Blue heelers are they were bred to run cattle. I think they're sort of cattle dogs from Australia. I'm not sure, but something like that. So what a blue heeler does is he kind of knocks into you a lot, even if you're a human, because he wants to direct which way you go. You know, in a way, a Sheltie is also a shepherding dog. But Shelties are meant to work with sheep, and blue heelers are meant to work with cattle. So they have to be really strong because the cattle could kick them, and they have to be very persistent. And that's the character that is bred into them. So I don't know that anything happened to him in his puppyhood. I really don't. He's a very sweet dog. You know, he's very sweet with humans. As long as he's not, you know, competing. Yeah, he's very territorial and he wants undivided attention. And of course I can't give him that because Leo was here first, but I can be very kind to him when I'm just with him and not with Leo. Yeah, yeah. So your mom's cat, Chevy, kicks people out of bed? Does Bo eat cake? Yes, Bo eats cake. He likes all kinds of cake. In fact, I made him sort of a chocolate pie recently that he's really been enjoying. Oh, he elongates himself. Okay. All right. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes. Yeah. We had a dog named Taman a long time ago. And in those days, Bo was a little baby. And, you know, he had his own playpen to sleep in, but sometimes I would have him in the bed with me. And Taman would try to put herself between us, you know, and, you know, get closer to me than Bo was. Oh, good grief. What do you think about this William person? Julia, do you think I should kick him out? Yeah. Okay. Sometimes when people are like that, I wonder, you know, are you a troll, mister? But yeah, I'm gonna. Okay. Oh no. Okay, yeah, I don't know. I think I messed up here. It's hard for me to moderate, so I had to put someone in a timeout, but I put the wrong person in. So I apologize. Yeah, so there are lots of conflicts. The conflicts can be resolved, but I just really don't know. I think that one fox should not be able to disable the entire flock, but I'm not sure. So I'm going to share again. Going to share again our lead-in. I'm going to now show you the other video for those people who have not been watching the whole stream. So I'm going to show you the other video. Thank you. We might have someone joining us very shortly on the stream. Hi, Julia.
Hi, how you doing? Oh, this is pretty.
Yeah. I'm so glad to have you on.
Yay. I'm excited to be on. So I love your talk about the chickens and the dogs. It was a lot of fun and interesting.
Yeah, let me just let me stop this and we can just have a talk.
I miss the duckies. I want to get a duck, but I couldn't keep one in an apartment, but I love ducks.
Yeah, my mother, I think, had one. I don't know why this is looking like that. I was wanting to have both of us same size.
There we go. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. So when we lived, you know, in a regular suburban house way back when, my mother, first she had chickens, but then the dog got the chickens. This is something that happens a lot. It happens a lot. And William says, hello, Julia. So then she kept a duck in the front yard. And then, of course, some dog came along and killed the duck in the front yard. It wasn't our dog, but
yeah,
it
happens.
Yeah, so it's really hard to decide how to do this. And I thought I'd found the perfect way because, keeping them in the backyard just hadn't worked out. You know, the other time, it was years ago when Sword was little and she was in charge of the chickens. And we actually had a rooster, too. People say, oh, you need a rooster to protect her. Nah. The dogs got the rooster first, and then they got the hens.
I think they just think the rooster, but he's going to be small. Like, he's a fowl, so I don't know.
Yeah, no, it was a massacre, and we were so demoralized about it that we didn't have chickens for a long time. And I had to think about it, you know, what can I do to make that work, make it work for us?
I think you had a good plan. It's just you can't anticipate a fox going wild and doing things that are unprecedented, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And you know what? And I probably didn't listen to you as much either because you were telling me about the fact that your family did have a fox close to where you were and that fox was kind of tame, right?
He was. The only thing, also another thing that my mom was wondering about, and we're not sure if it was like a wild fox or a fox. There used to be like somebody that bred foxes nearby. So there are some wild foxes in the mountains, but she was led to believe maybe it had some sort of interaction with people. Because it seemed a little bit different because we were talking about this the other day. I asked her, I said, do you think it was a wild fox or do you think we think it might have had some exposure to people? Maybe that's why it was acting like that. It was kind of different.
Yeah. It actually seems to me that in areas that are, you know, more settled, not necessarily a city, but a suburb or
like a suburb. Yeah, the mountains are definitely a suburb now for sure.
Okay. Something happens to the wild animals where they start to act different, even though they haven't been owned by anybody. And it's not that they were tamed, but I noticed that, you know, that like even birds, you know, they're just walk around. They don't run away from you. You know, they don't fly away.
No, they don't. You're right.
And the deer, for instance, when I visit my mother in Bloomington, Indiana, the deer, let me get a lot closer than the deer do here.
I've heard like in recent years, like in suburban areas, that deer populations have gone up and they'll eat down gardens if you don't have like some sort of a fence to keep them out. I've heard that anyway.
Right. And they become more like pests and less like wild animals. And I'm wondering, is there maybe too much settlement here where I am? Is this affecting the fox? I don't know. I don't think so, but.
I don't think so either. Another thing, though, that kind of bothers me is I kind of wish they would stop tracking the wildlife, like putting a tracker on them. Like they always say that's for science, but I kind of wish they would just let them be. Like I feel like maybe we're disrupting their natural patterns when we st I felt that way since I was a child, really.
It's kind of startling to see a collar on a wolf, for instance. Cats show cat, and if you want them to be wild, they shouldn't have a collar, right?
They shouldn't. And I started thinking, like, they were talking about this one cougar. They're like, why did he go out of his vicinity? And why is he going into neighborhoods and eating out of trash? And I was thinking, maybe it's because when they took him to put the collar on him, he started thinking, oh, maybe I can be around people and they have tasty yummies for me. So maybe it kind of disrupted his natural pattern, you know? That's just my thought.
Yeah, well, I don't know, but the other side of it, is that you can't totally protect predators. Yes, I love wolves. I love foxes. I don't want them to go extinct, not at all. And I liked the idea that I had a fox on my property. I did. But the other side is you have to give pushback. I don't believe in this kindness thing where
That doesn't work. And I think like in an ideal world, they always tell us like you need to be kind, but then at the end of the day, like I just think about like even as a human, like if you're kind to everybody, they'll take advantage of you. Like, oh, okay, like oh, can you give me change? And people like they'll rob you. Like you have to be careful. You know, you can't just give a handout to everybody, but that's just my take on it, you know.
I told you the story about the we were in the park. It was in my rice years, and somebody said he needed money, and it would everybody's like that. And I said, well, I don't have any money, but here, have a Coke. It was like a commercial.
Yeah, I think that's fair. And my friend used to do that too. She would give people like granola bars, and then some people after she did that, which was kindness, right? They got mad at her. They got mad.
You have to kind of let people know there's a limit to what you would do, and the same thing with a fox. The fox has to be afraid of us. He can't, he can't really think that it's okay to get close.
There needs to be some boundaries. I don't know. Is this just indicative because our population's going up and more people, like when I was a kid, I don't think as many people were as interested in like going out in the, but it seems like now even here in California, it's becoming a bigger thing to like, oh, let's go out to the mountains and the desert and let's go look at wildlife. But instead of giving them distance, they'd always be like, don't feed the bears. But that's what people do. And they're like chasing bears with iPhones. And I feel like we're not giving the wildlife enough distance, you know?
Right, but they also need to give us a distance. So,
Well, we should. I mean, we don't want them attacking people's animals. And of course not. They should be scared of us, definitely.
a little bit of pushback I think is necessary. The reason I'm thinking about that is I'm thinking about what Kathy told me, and I don't remember in the it's in the states that are adjoining the park where the wolves were introduced, and the wolves, actually made life better because having predators makes all of the prey actually healthier. So it was all great. But then there are these farmers, who have herds of their own that they're protecting. And so a lot of the conservationists think that they shouldn't protect their herds, you know, or they shouldn't, you know, it's one thing. I don't think they should go after wolves in their area and just try to exterminate them. But I do think that if a wolf goes after livestock, that it should be okay to shoot that particular wolf, not all of them, but, you know, that one.
Yeah, when it's especially if it's going on your land and it's taking your livestock, that's a different scenario, you know.
Right. And I think that people are too, it's almost like the abortion thing. Mm-hmm. People are too one-sided on all of it.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like there's a simple, like, I've been thinking about that too. I don't know. I just feel like everything's so messy right now. People are so mad. Like, I don't know what, I kind of, like, I feel a certain way, but I don't, like, want to argue with people. And that's what everybody wants to do at the moment. So they all
It's all so, you know, it's all either never do this or always do this. You know, and it's just, instead of just letting people decide what they're going to do. Yeah,
the whole equilibrium thing, it's, like, off in a lot of areas, so to speak.
Right.
Like, good analogy that you have, you know, about the equilibrium.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I think that, I mean, it's kind of like even people stealing, a different analogy. Right now they're telling people who work in stores to ignore it if people are, you know, shoplifting. I don't think that's a good idea.
That really bothers me a lot, actually. Somebody did that the other day. Okay. I saw it happen. Okay. They got caught because, there were only two people working at CVS and only one person was running the cash register. And all these people threw the biggest fit in their life. We don't want to wait in the line. Like, oh no, it's been 5 minutes and they're all panicking. Oh my gosh. They seem to be okay. I don't know what, they didn't seem like they were running. So this one guy said, I wonder where the cameras are. I heard him say it. And he walked out with everything. So the lady that was taking her lunch break had to come back in and herd him back into the CVS. Oh, you need to pay. So he basically jumped the line, but he was going to steal because he just told everybody, where's the camera? Well, the camera's everywhere. He just didn't care because obviously he's done it before. So he wasn't too worried about it. That was interesting.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they actually, a lot of these stores, tell their employees not to run after thieves because it might be dangerous for them. And as a result of that policy, you know, it's encouraging that behavior. So in those places where, you know, there are draconian laws, you know, like Singapore, nothing like that ever happened.
And look, Singapore is very clean and they don't have graffiti and they have a lower crime rate too. So, because you know you're going to get caned if you do that.
Right, right. So it's not that I'm, you know, for caning or for, say, cutting off a thief's hand or anything like that. But if you don't have reasonable, you know, pushback to that bad behavior, it's just going to proliferate.
Yeah, that's so true. And you are right. There are, like, a lot of stores will tell them, well, you can't go after them. And even if you're not going after them, you call the police, that same CVS, the police don't even come for like 2 hours. You're like, oh, okay. Well, by then they're off. I don't know.
Yeah. So,
repercussion.
Sorry?
I said there's no repercussions.
Yeah. So that's why I thought that after I chased the fox and prevented him from actually eating, you know, the duck that he caught, that maybe he wouldn't come around again. But then he went and killed a chicken and ate its head through the gap. And that is just so wonderful, you know, because the rest of the body was hanging out. And
okay, that is so strange to me. I feel like there's something wrong. Like, I know maybe the farmers were saying it's not rabid, but that doesn't sound like typical behavior for a fox. It just seems really
out of place. I've never seen anything like this. I've never seen a box turtle with its head, you know, decapitated like that. I've never.
That's so strange. Did you ask Kathy about it? Like, does Kathy have some thoughts? Like, maybe she has some insight.
No, I haven't, but I will. I
I think
will.
she might. I would talk to her about it because I would like to hear what she thinks about that situation.
Yeah, she should know. She should definitely know a lot more about that than I do. So yeah, I will ask her. I don't know. It's just, on the one hand, I really don't, I feel that I almost like betrayed my flock because they were counting on me to let them out every night. They would come in because they knew they were going to get to go out, you know.
Well, I don't think that favorite, I think favorite chicken is very adept, and I think she knows, like she realizes what's going on, and I don't think, I mean, they're chickens and ducks. They know that there's predators in the world. And yeah, they rely on you, but we can't guarantee everything in life. So I don't think they're holding a grudge or anything. I mean,
Well, not for the fox, you know, killing people, yeah, killing them. But
yeah.
I mean, for me, not letting them out, this is what I'm feeling
Like you
bad.
feel like, yeah, they probably feel cooped up, like literally. People feel cooped up. I get what you're saying, though. They probably want to roam around. They don't want to just be in there all the time.
Yeah, and I think it's healthier for them to roam around. Of course, it's not healthy to be killed. That's a different issue.
No. I guess it comes down to this, like you want them to be safe, but then if they can never roam around again, like their quality of life, like that's sad for them. But I don't have the answers. You guys know more about it than I do, so that's just, I don't know.
No, I don't know. I'm almost on the verge on letting them go. And of course, then if one of them gets killed, you know, everybody will say, well, that's your fault. You let them go. But what, you know, it seems like a catch 22, whatever I do.
I mean, the thing is, you had them in the coop, and then one reached in any. It's a bad situation because you can't predict what the fox is going to do no matter what. So it's
Yeah,
kind
I've
of,
been plugging the gap, but
oh,
that
well, yeah, you're right.
I've been plugging the gap so that didn't happen again. But and I don't even know if the fox is still around. Maybe somebody shot him, but how would I know?
Yeah, there's no way to know. Well, I mean, maybe there is. I wonder if you can think about. Well, I think it's just a hard situation.
Yeah, it's definitely. So, I don't know. I don't like the way it's turned out.
I always love seeing all your videos of them wandering around, and I thought it was really neat. But you know what's beautiful is you still have those videos, and that's a beautiful experience that a lot of ducks and chickens never get to have because they are cooped. So I think they had a wonderful life. I do, if you look
Yeah,
at
they
it.
did.
I mean,
You know, and it, you know, each one of them has a personality, and Drake was definitely no saint.
no,
You
he
know.
wasn't. But they, I love their personalities. You know, in the little videos, you
Yeah.
can see it.
Yeah.
I mean, I just try to think of like the bet. I'm not saying what was good that happened, but at least they enjoyed their life more than some ducks and chickens might have. I try to look at that way, you know.
Yeah. That's definitely true. I still do have all those beautiful videos of them and beautiful memories. But I wish I knew where the fox was, just to know if I can or can't let them out.
It's hard to see in this situation. We'll never really know because it's a wild animal, and we don't want to be the type of person that tracks it. Like, you know, that would be like the sign they want to track. It's hard because we don't know. Some things in life are not certain, and I want them to be safe, but we can't be certain of everything when it comes to wildlife, you know?
Right. You know, it's the same thing with children. Now, most children are not allowed to walk to school alone. They're not allowed to, you know, go to the mall alone. And it's all because of predators, you know. But
But what if, you know, when they are at school, like that bad guy that got in, and it turned out, I guess the mom, one of the moms was better at getting her kids out, then I not to go into that, but I'm just saying, we don't know. Like, things can happen at any time. I think telling kids they can never play outside is not the answer.
Right. I agree. So that's why I kind of think that maybe telling the ducks and chickens they can never go out is also probably not the right thing.
Maybe you can just test the waters. Like, I don't know, there's a way to just like monitor the situation.
I can't. Okay. What you have to understand is once they open the door and they go, they leave.
You're right.
I can't catch them. You know, they can come back at the end of the day if they're okay. But, you know, I cannot, totally cannot watch them all the time. And once they're off, you know, most of them, when they're healthy, I can't catch them.
You're right. That's the catch 22 about this, I guess.
Yeah. So it's not, I can't do that. If I let them out, they're out on their own for the whole day until they decide to come back.
I mean, it's kind of like kids back in the day when they got to go outside, and then when the street lights come on, you come home. Like, that was a thing back in the day, right? You know?
Yeah. Yeah. That was it. That was definitely it.
And I kind of feel like life was better. Childhood was more fun, better experiences. Like, I don't know, my sister, she used to get really upset when she heard kids outside playing and riding the bikes. And I'm like, you know what? You should be happy that their parents let them go outside and have fun, because a lot of kids, their parents don't let them go out and they have to stay inside. And I always was happy when I saw kids playing outside. I thought, that's great.
Yeah, it is great. Yeah.
I mean, nowadays, especially because I see a lot of kids that their parents don't even want them to walk across the street by themselves after like the age of 8 or something. And it's like, wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And they don't even think that at age 12, they can be left alone in the house, you know, which is weird.
Well, that's flabbergasts me, because when we were kids, they like did this little like class. Like, I mean, I already knew how to babysit, but it was just basics. They're like, here's how to make like food for your younger siblings, or if you babysit or do CPR. And I thought that was really cool. But now they're like, oh no, you can't leave a 12-year-old home alone. But that's not realistic. And that's kind of punishing poor people, because they can't afford a nanny. And sometimes they need the older sibling to watch the younger kids when mom's working, you know?
Yeah. And kids used to make money babysitting for the neighbors. So,
and that too, like, it's like they're making it impossible for kids to, like, I don't know, make money these days. Yeah. It makes it hard. And it was fun. Like, babysitting was fun. Like, it's not mandatory, but I did it a few times and I got paid pretty well to do it. I liked it.
Yeah, I liked it too. I mean, yeah, I used to do that.
So I guess it's just the equilibrium thing. You'll have to kind of weigh the situation and see what will happen.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll have to do what I have to do. And if it doesn't turn out the best, I might not even share with everybody exactly what's going on, because I don't really need the blame, you know?
Don't have to tell anybody. This is your decision, I think. It's just an interesting discussion. But yeah, at the end of the day, it's your decision, I say.
Right. Yeah. Because I like on Facebook, I've sort of not shared that much about it anymore, because some people were very, you know, judgmental.
Yeah, that's another thing. I do post certain things on Facebook, but I don't even like to post a lot, because it gets weird really quick and people have a lot of opinions, and I'm just like, sometimes that's not helpful.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I support whatever you decide to do. And I think they had a beautiful life. And of course, you wanted them to be able to keep enjoying their time. We can't predict what's going to happen with a wild animal. You know, we just can't
predict things. Yeah, that's true. And maybe that fox was just passing through. That's the thing. I don't know, you know, if this is a permanent fixture.
Yeah. And like you said, maybe a neighbor shot him because if he, I don't know, attacked some sort of livestock, I could see that happening. We don't know.
Yeah. So do you have anything else to share about your day or things?
That- Well, oh yeah. Interesting, like talking about the concept of be nice and kill people with niceness or kindness. It goes back to something I was talking about. It didn't happen today, but it happened a couple weeks ago, and I kind of been Googling, and I think it's a scam. Like I don't know if I told you about this, but I was shopping at Walmart one night, and this guy came up to me, and he was holding some sort of electronic. And this is the second time I've had somebody say something similar to me. He's like, can you buy this for me? And I said, no. He goes, oh, no. I want to pay cash for it, but I need you to buy it on my card. And I said, no way. And I walked away. He goes, but, and I should have just ignored him when I first heard him saying, ma'am. But that was weird. So after I checked out, I told the person checking the receipts at the door, I said, I think somebody's pulling a scam. Because why could you not buy it with cash? Like, what are you trying to do? That was weird. And I didn't even want to hear what he had to say. I didn't stick around. So, you know, that whole like empathy thing, like, oh, I feel so sorry. And this is another scam I heard about is like some people, they feel sorry for the family at the gas station. They're like, oh, our car is broken down and we're stranded. Can you give us some cash? And people end up giving them cash and they're making hundreds of dollars doing that. It's like a side job for them.
Yeah, you have to really watch out for those people.
There's another scam. It's the funeral scam. This is a really bad one. And I can't believe people go this low. Okay, so they take a picture of their loved one and they stand near the freeway off ramp. And they're well-dressed people. They don't look like they're like starving or anything. They look pretty good. Okay. So they have signs. They're like, our loved one just died and we can't afford to buy a burial plot for them. We don't want to cremate them. It's against our religion. Please give us money. And people are giving them money and it's another scam. Like there are some scams lately that are kind of popping up more than they're used to. There's always been scams, but just more like out in the light of day. Like, and then people get mad at you if you don't want to help them. And I'm like, I just keep walking. I'm like, oh my God. And one other thing that did happen. The other day, somebody kept trying to talk to me, and I said, no, I've just had some weird, I don't know. Anyway, just weird behavior.
Well, can you elaborate how they were talking to you or
Okay,
what?
so I was walking, and this guy just kept saying, ma'am, ma'am. And I didn't want to acknowledge him because, look, the other day when I looked at somebody at the Walmart, and they tried to get me to buy that electronic for them. So if I'm walking, I don't want to turn around and talk to somebody who keeps like trying to get my attention. This feels predatory. Maybe they had a good intention, but I don't think so. I don't think that they need to talk to me. If their car was broken down, they can call a towing company. Why do they need to talk to me? And then he kept following me to the intersection. He's like, ma'am. And I said, you know what? I said, you keep going, you cross, and you just go. And he did. But later down the road near the post office next to the Walmart, I saw like, I'm not saying that it's related, but I saw like somebody's purse with stuff like strewn out, like it was somebody's bag and just on the, that was weird.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
But
So I was
he
like,
didn't get your bag.
no. But I feel like somebody wasn't even, that wasn't robbery. I feel like that was maybe abduction. I don't know if what's going on, but I feel like some things I'm seeing are human.
Well, you know what they do if they're, what do you call the people who just get your purse and run? What do you
Like
call those guys?
pickpockets, I guess. Like,
Yeah, but big pocket,
there's
you
another term for them, like a, I don't know, like a snatcher, purse snatcher.
yeah, purse snatcher. Yeah, okay, that's it. Okay, so what a purse snatcher will do, and I don't, not that I've ever had that experience, but I think what they would do is they would run past someone, get their purse, run off, and then throw the purse away because they don't want it, the evidence.
Oh, like maybe that.
They just take the cash and throw everything away.
Oh, that could explain it. That, because that was really strange. I was like, oh, okay.
So maybe he decided he couldn't get your purse,
I don't know. There's just some weird activity, things I've never seen like as much. But I feel like after the pandemic, more people are moving up here to our area, so there's more illicit activity that we never really had here before. like with, well, people are having their packages stolen. That's one thing. Luckily, I haven't had that problem lately. I'm pretty lucky, but I know like in some of the neighborhoods, like that never used to happen up here.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Well, I guess I'm kind of lucky that we don't have any human problems around here. It's just the fox.
I mean, that's not good either, though. There's different types of problems, but I would hope that one day, if you want to let your flock out again, that they could go outside, you know?
Yeah, I hope so. I feel that I don't want to keep them cooped in very much longer because, you know, even though I give them the best food and stuff, they're not happy. They're just not.
That's the thing. When people are caged, does the cage bird sing? I mean, it might, but why is it singing? That's always been a question. Like, it might be, they like to be caged, but sometimes if they're used to roaming, they want to roam, right? I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, I know, because this also, there are implications about Bo as well. But Bo is really very patient, and I think he's happy.
Well, I think Bo is fine. I was thinking more about, like, birds and chickens, though. Like, not.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, I do have birds. I have Summer, the Quaker parrot, and I do open the cage. Yeah. So Summer gets to fly around.
See, but some people probably don't ever let their parrot fly around.
I have the cockatiels, and I did try to, you know, I told you that a while back. I opened the door because I thought, hey, why shouldn't they be able to fly too?
But they didn't want to.
They got spooked, and then because of Summer, you know, he's bigger than they are. And so then they flew off and they were all over the shelves and they looked really scared. And So it seemed like they were much happier when I got them back in the cage.
I mean, you know, yeah, I mean, that's what I'm saying. Some birds might not want to, but I think with like chickens and ducks, like if they've wandered around, they enjoy that, right?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, when I first, you know, cause I raised them from little ducklings,
little
yeah. And of course they weren't roaming at first. I raised them in the bathtub.
That's so cool. I remember when they used to float around in the bathtub. That's so cool.
Yeah. So anyway, once I got them out there for a while, they were still cooped up in the pen. It was brand new. Everything was shiny and everything. And Sword came home, you know, for a visit. And she said, you need to let them out of there. They can't stay in there forever. And so she got me to get up the courage to open the door and let them out. Because I was, you know, when you raise them, you don't want to lose them, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Because they're like your little baby. They're cute baby.
Yeah. But then when I saw how happy they were and how happy they were to return to the coop at the end of the day, you know, I just thought it was ideal.
It was ideal. I thought it was really neat because I had never really seen a situation. And I just loved how Favorite Chicken like was so neat, her personality, and Drake, even though I know he could kind of be like mean sometimes. I liked his personality. They all had personalities that I thought were really cool.
Yeah, no. Before I saw the fox, you know, I thought, well, did Favorite Chicken do something to Drake? Because he was always so mean to her, but she didn't. It was a fox.
I mean, at the end of the day, it just doesn't make, I guess there's an explanation for why a fox would act this way, but it just seems out of nature for a fox, like this particular pattern.
I'm thinking maybe it's a young fox.
That could be. That hasn't had much experience, that would explain it. So do you have any more thoughts on animals or like more observations about animals that you wanted to share with us?
Well, you know, just the thing that I already said about the stray dogs, you know, the fact that they were mean in Taiwan to the stray dogs actually made the stray dogs have limits and boundaries and so the dogs could actually be free.
Yeah.
You know? And I think sometimes if you don't allow people to push back against wild animals, then the animals will end up being exterminated, you know, or, you know, put in a zoo or something.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of headed that way, and I don't like that. I don't want animals in captivity. I don't think that's good for animals, like zoos. I don't know.
It's complicated, but, you know, the thing about the sanctuaries, they pretend that they give lots of room. They can't. They really can't.
No, they don't. And I feel like I've kind of heard, like, things about them that aren't always so good. I know they want to promote themselves as, oh, we're so, but it's a little bit different when you start looking into it, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, at the end of the day, I just don't want to see, like, coyotes never be able to roam free, because, you know, they actually had coyotes in the LA Zoo, and I thought that was weird. I'm like, you're coyotes. Why are you in a zoo? Like, what? A coyote in a zoo? That just seemed absurd to me.
I know. And we do have coyotes, and they never, ever bother us, you know?
I actually kind of like the coyotes because, like, I mean, I don't always admire everything they do. Sometimes they would do, like, get into trash and stuff, but, you know, just secure your trash better. But there's just something about them, like, they're kind of tricksters. Before they became more acclimated to people, like, their patterns were very fascinating. And they made little trails. Like, when I was a kid, you would go down in the forest and there'd be this little coyote trail going down the side of the cliff. And it was just always fascinating, like, to see their habitat.
Yeah. And we hear them and they never bother us, you know? And so that, and up till now, the foxes didn't bother us either.
Yeah. I mean, I can vouch for that. Like I said, I've seen coyotes. I grew up around them. I had a dog actually that was half coyote. I told you about that, right?
Our
dog.
Yes, you did.
And I thought she was a really interesting dog. Like she was different. And then our dog Keenan, even though he was like basically looked like a German shepherd, I think he was more like a coyote. So I feel like maybe I have like a certain affinity with coyotes because I had a dog that was part coyote. So I kind of am attuned to their behavior a little bit more, if that makes any sense. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I want all the animals to be out there. And I've heard that the bears are coming back here.
Oh.
I have not seen a bear on my property yet, but
oh, did somebody
one of my neighbors caught a picture of a black bear on his property.
Wow.
But again, you know, it's okay to have bears. It's not okay to have bears, say, attacking humans. That's a difference. You know?
No, that's not okay. But another thing about the bears is, yeah, we want some pushback, definitely. I don't think they should attack humans or livestock. But I'm still concerned about people that chase like a bear up the street with an iPhone, like, come here. I want to make a video of you. You're not Yogi the Bear, man. Like, just let him be. But this guy was literally chasing a bear up the street, like with his iPhone, like, oh, come on, come back. I want to make a video of you. You might have a different kind of TikTok. I don't know if you want that, you know?
Yeah, no, I would not do that. So I think we should have wildlife and they should remain wild, you know?
Yeah. And I have seen a bear actually. I thought it was going to attack me, but it was running after something. I was like, oh my God. And it went out of me and it, you know, I mean, I don't know if it would have attacked me, like if it wasn't running after something else, but I'm like, yeah, I acted scared and it went, arr. I'm not saying that I don't know. That was interesting though. So I learned my lesson. Like I used to go walking way deep into the desert side of the mountain by myself. That wasn't a good idea.
Okay. All right. Well, it's a wonderful experience that you have that you can tell about and you weren't hurt at all. So
no,
that's
I wasn't. See, that's another thing though. I'm starting to think differently about it. Like I was scared at the time, but then I thought, well, the bear didn't attack me though. I have to think about it that way. Right.
Right.
I don't know. Like that's a good point.
Yeah.
Except it was really embarrassing because I got really scared and I like flagged down a sheriff to give me a ride home. And they're like, what's wrong? I said, there was a bear. He was chasing me. The guy didn't believe me, but anyway.
Oh, wow.
I just should have walked home. I just freaked out that way. So, but that was my bear story.
Well, the best stories, unfortunately, no picture. I wish I wish some tourist had been coming down, caught a picture of you with the bear.
I know. That would have been really neat. I mean, I would love to have pictures of those candid moments sometimes, but here's another thing I have been thinking recently. All these wonderful stories that we have about interactions with wildlife, they just seem more amazing in a way than like, oh, sometimes when people are just like, I like to film wildlife myself, but you know, like the people that follow the bear, I don't know. Like it just, sometimes the stories just resonate with me more than like, it's interesting, but I would have loved to have a picture of the bear for sure.
Yeah.
Or me being scared by the bear, that would have been an interesting. I thought he was a coyote at first, honestly, because I would always see coyotes run by. I was never scared. By the way, that was another thing I was going to say. Coyotes ran by me all the time, and I never had fear of them. Like, they didn't bother me. They never harassed me.
Oh, that's interesting. We don't see ours at all, you see. I mean, there. I do have a coyote story where one actually ran into my car, you know, and I'm not saying I ran into it. It just kind of, it was running into the road and here's my car going like this and it hit the side of my car. And I stopped and I wanted to see if I could help it. You know, I even started to pick it up and thinking that I would take it to the vet.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it had a broken neck, so it was dead.
I mean, that happens, unfortunately. That's why there are signs like, oh, deers and coyotes. But I actually did end up having to tell somebody there was a, I don't know what happened to this coyote. I don't think he died of natural causes. It was kind of sad. Like, there was just a dead coyote that was dumped on the side of the mountain once. And I think somebody did something to him and just threw him there. That was kind of sad.
I think we were having a connection issue, so I was able to make out.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, I'm just saying one time when I was still living in the mountains, like I saw a dead coyote. I ended up letting some people know that they needed to move him because he was just decomposing on the hillside, but it didn't look like natural causes. It looked like somebody had just killed him and dumped him on the hillside. And that kind of made me sad because I'm like, I felt like they should have not done that.
Yeah.
But I guess what I was trying to say is sometimes animals cross. We've seen a lynx, like a mountain lion, and other things cross like the roads up there quite often too. Not all the time. But we did see those things. I've seen a deer running down the road one time, but they didn't come close. They always kept running. The deer's, I never could get close to them. Can you hear me? I guess.
Am I frozen for you? Because you're frozen for me.
No, I mean, it's just like I was talking. And I guess you didn't hear me. Like, it's, I guess I'm frozen. Do you hear me now?
I hear you now, but your picture is frozen.
Oh, that's weird. I don't know. I guess I should, maybe I should sign off, you think, since I seem to be freezing up. I'm sorry.
Sorry? Okay, I can, you're moving now, so.
Okay, that's, yeah. I don't know what happened, but I guess all I was just telling a story about wildlife and how I have seen them cross the road and run across the road a few times, you know.
Yeah, you're back now. Okay. It was just one of those weird things, you know, like your voice got kind of elongated and then for a while you froze, but you're back.
I guess that's just one of the fun things about StreamYard. Sometimes it freezes up and, you know.
Yeah. But,
I mean, I do appreciate StreamYard. It's a free streaming service. So I do love it. Like, it does have benefits, but sometimes I'm just like, oh, that's kind of strange.
Right. I'm still hoping to someday master OBS, but
I kind of like recently I was thinking about it, but I finally got my big computer to come back to life. So I'm like, oh, do I want to chance it? But I sort of started getting curious. I'm like, maybe last time I had the wrong attitude towards OBS. Maybe I should have been. But I'll tell you what made me change my mind. You know, the one video that's getting the most views on my channel right now, my old channel, is Lamont. Yeah. You and I did that with OBS, which was really interesting. It didn't look good. It didn't look professional, but it looked okay. I don't know. Maybe it's just getting a lot of views because I showed some footage from the movie. But that is my most viewed video right now. It's up like, well, I have ones that are higher, but what's driving my traffic at the moment is that particular video because people are very interested in the review of that movie. So
was that on your California?
Yeah, that was on the California Art and Mountain Life. So it kind of made me think, well, maybe I had the wrong attitude towards OBS because I thought, you know, I made this video with OBS and it seems to be doing well. And yes, it doesn't look professional, but it's interesting. Like it looks better than some of my other videos. So I thought, well, maybe I was premature in giving up on OBS. I don't know.
Well, if you ever want to, you know, do a stream together where we're both on OBS, I think that would be interesting.
I think we should try it one of these days, right? Like to see if we can start, because I feel like I want to get more into the actual technology and I do want to conquer because OBS was really making. So I feel like maybe that's something I need to learn because I kind of wrote it off. I'm like, it's so hard. But I need to learn it probably.
Yeah, I think everybody knows that it's not very user friendly, but it seems to work really well once you master it.
No, it works really well. And all the really professional looking streamers that are using OBS, and OBS is better than OBS Streamlabs because OBS Streamlabs is just a skin. Like it's just like it gives you options. But I thought, well, why don't you just use OBS then?
Right. Yeah, I think OBS is the thing to learn how to use. It's just that it's so daunting for me.
Yeah, that was the thing when I used it, like, well, in that one video, you can see how I used it, but I would have to do a lot more practice on, like, the screen background because I would always have part of the screen showing and then other windows would pop up. And I know there's a way to do it seamlessly by programming the keys and going back and forth. I kind of was learning a little bit, but then that's when the big computer started taking its tumble. So I reset it a few times. And
then I mean, they have keys for everything. So like you can moderate your chat. For instance, I was having trouble today moderating my chat. I didn't mean to.
It was actually kind of funny because
I was trying to go for the other.
I mean,
but, yeah, so I mean, they have things like they can have a command that says, hey, would you like to subscribe or become a member or any of those things? And you don't have to bother with typing it, you know, over and over and over again.
That's true. Like it's just there and it's easy. You hit the command. And then I know some people use that switcher, right? That makes it even easier once you get really good at it, apparently.
Yeah, yeah. Then you can have a switcher, but I understand that first you have to learn how to use it. Otherwise, the switcher won't help.
Yeah, I think, like, I'm basically a toddler when it comes to OBS. I have a lot more to learn. But I was kind of interested in the fact that that one video I made with it, I didn't say it looks the best. It looks better than some of my other videos, I think. But that's like driving my channel traffic right now. So I thought that was interesting when I thought about it.
Yeah. That really makes a difference. You know, we really need to find out what it is that drives the traffic.
I feel like we really do need to tap into that. But also too, that's another thing that I think some people are kind of frustrated with. Like there are some channels that are doing, they're getting a lot of subscribers really quick, but I guess one lady was actually kind of disappointed because she's making these really professional videos about being an expat in Istanbul. And I guess she was saying, she goes, I feel like some of my videos don't have a lot of views. And I was looking at her videos. They have a lot more views than our videos, maybe, but yeah, it's not what it used to be. It's not, YouTube videos just aren't, you can still do well, but I think there's just a lot of competition with TikTok right now. Like, I don't know, other apps. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah. Oh, the thing is, TikTok is a completely different audience, I think.
It is. And it's very short attention span theater. I can only take so much. I look at a little bit of it, but then I can't look at it much more. Like, I'll look at a couple of things and then I just put it away. I'm not that interested. Like, I can't spend 5 hours on there. Some people do. Why? I don't know. But
yeah, I don't feel that I'm competing with TikTok because my content is completely different.
No, you're doing long form, informative, like scholarly content. So it's completely different.
Yeah.
So I think for you, though, I think just we need to get videos to an audience that's looking for them. I think we just need to figure out what the search engine strategy is at the moment. That's it.
Yeah. But we can do that.
We will.
Yeah, we will. And I think we, you know, on the other channel, art videos.
Mm-hmm. I've been liking those a lot. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it is. And I think there is something to it. So, yeah. And I have the third channel, Inverted A Press. And today we had an interview in Hebrew on it.
Oh, that is so exciting. I have to look. I mean, I'm not going to really understand much.
I know. But actually, he did translate some English poems. So he did read one poem in English by Edmund Burke about the mirror. You know, how when we look in the mirror after we're a certain age, we blame the mirror. You know, we think that, you know, the mirrors of today are not as good as the mirrors 30 years ago. So anyway, he translated that from English to Hebrew, but he read the English one too.
Well, I'll have to listen and take a watch and I'll probably get a little bit of it, but it would be, I like to hear Hebrew and Arabic and Turkish. I love to hear those languages, even if I don't understand much of it. It's very beautiful to listen to.
Well, I mean, the other thing is one day we're going to study Turkish together, right?
I want to study Turkish. I need to order a Turkish book, but yes, I want to do that. I actually do want to do that. I do want to begin to master the grammar of Turkish. And another thing I've just been looking more into is because, okay, I guess Ataturk, he's such a polarizing character. I'm not saying everything he did was good, but some people really love him and some people really hate him. But the one thing I think that we can just say that was positive, I'm not saying everything he did. I'm not into like, being a statist, but I do like that he made the alphabet intelligible and easy for people to read and write. That's interesting. That, like, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, I like the way he regularized the language. I think maybe the language wasn't nearly as neat as he put it together, you know, and made very regular rules. And I like it. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that part, I feel like I can admire him for. Some of his other stances, I'm like, yeah, there are some things about him. I wouldn't act like he's a god. Like, some people act like, oh my god, he's the best thing that ever happened since sliced bread. No, I won't take it that far, but I can admire some of the things that he did when it came to like modernizing the language and bringing in the Roman alphabet, and then like the C's with that little squiggly, what's the name of that squiggly thing on the bottom of the C's that makes the CH sound?
The deal.
Yeah, see, I do like that because it makes a lot of sense. And it makes more sense than English in a lot of ways, you know?
Well, yeah, English changed so many times and borrowed so many things that it doesn't have a regular spelling system.
Yes, definitely not. But, I mean, that's just one thing I thought was interesting. That's why I always wanted to see if Kate's friends contact, but I know that he is a busy person, but I think we could learn Turkish on our own, so we can do that.
Yeah, we definitely should.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so wonderful that you were able to come on tonight at such short notice.
No, I was happy to do it. I was home tonight, and I was glad to talk with you about your chickens. I love to hear your chicken stories and ducks and
Okay, very good. And so we'll say good night and I'll see you again on Sunday.
Yeah, we'll paint and draw and have a ball with art supplies and drawing and all that good stuff.
Okay, good night.
Good night.